All right, beautiful, beautiful. So let's go now. How many times do you have to say that? Three, right? Let's go. God is good.
We have to give to them. So nobody need to worry that
you know, people will be embarrassed here and all that. No, no, no. We do not do that. Amen? Amen? But I emphasize again, we do not take stuff here and carry for persons. We invite persons to come to the meetings. Amen? All right, beautiful. So let me ask my gentleman on the multimedia. She's off. Okay. Throw that phone up for me again. I want to keep that up until I actually get the real phone in my hand, that I can actually show you the real phone in my hand. All right? So while you're getting organized, I just want to give out two gifts this evening. Yes, two gifts this evening. And I want to target persons 15 to 20 years of age tonight here, visiting friends. If you are between that age, just stand wherever you are. Between 15 and 20, you are not a member, and you are visiting with us this evening. All right, so I'm going to take it up between 20 and 25. Ushers, come quickly and help me. 20 and 25, anybody? Okay, I'm going to take it up between 25 and 30. Okay, I'm going to take it up between 30 and 35. Okay, I'm going to take it up between 35 and 40. I'm going to take it up between 40 and 60. Anybody here that said this evening, you have never gotten a gift between that age? I see somebody motioning something to me. I've not seen somebody. First time she's coming? All right, beautiful. Let's stand first, please. Let's recognize her this evening. Okay, put your hands together for her. Come on. Put your hands together for her. Thanks for coming. Anybody else on this side, you want to receive my gift, the gift from the preacher this evening? You are visiting with us. You have not gotten anything yet. All right, nobody on this side. So I'm keeping my gift tonight. Somebody say the camera, man. Okay. Give me the camera, man. Come on, put your hands together for the camera, man. I didn't know we have a camera, man, here. I didn't know I was on TV, so I tell me. Well, you should have informed me that I'm on TV. I could have powdered my face. All right. It's good to be in God's house, amen. Okay, it's ready. The first hiding things for me. All right, so I'm about to go down. Those of you who brought somebody to be a part of our popularity contest, this phone on the screen, it's a Samsung Galaxy A23. We are going to make it available as the first prize for the person who would have brought over the period of these meetings the most persons out here. So last time there were two persons who got into the race. Anybody else want to join them here this evening? We had two who got into the race last night. One, yes. Now that area kind of darkish, and I no longer have 20/20 vision, right? So you help me. I want a name and how many persons? Give me your name, who are the person, invite the person.
Felix.
All right, Felix. And how many persons Felix got? Felix got himself. So who brought Felix? We need to know who took credit. What is your name, my sister? I didn't hear you.
Veronica.
All right, sister Veronica. All right. She bought one person. Put hands together for her. Remember the folks at the table, they are taking records, alright? So what we are saying is that once you bring somebody, you will stand up, tell us your name, tell us how many persons you bought. Okay, is that plain? Is that simple for us to understand? Alright, so you stand up, you tell us your name, and you tell us how many you bought, and you ask the persons you bought to also stand up so we can recognize them. Amen? May God bless us. as we continue to worship. Thank you.
Good night to everyone. Are you having a good time under the tent? Yes, I'm sure I'm having a good time. So we have been blessed so far by God, even in providing us this wonderful opportunity to be out here this evening. And I know because we have been blessed so much, we are very grateful. We are so grateful that we would have walked with a tangible offering to say how grateful we are. So this at this time, I just want us to stand by as we collect the evening's offering. Now let me just inform you that after the collecting of the offering, you will be treated with a special gift this evening. Gift of special music, which will be brought to you by Sister Natasha Goodman Batch. So let us bow our heads at this time. Can you please stand as we pray? Once more, Father, we are indeed grateful for spare life. We are grateful for the opportunity of being able to come below this beautiful canvas cathedral to receive a blessing from on high and to give you praise and thanks. Dear Father, we are also grateful for the fact that you took care of us throughout this day. And at this time, we just want to say thank you in a tangible way by presenting to you or offering. We ask that you will bless the offering this evening. Use it to bring others to know you. And we thank you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen.
Give us a come back to you with pleasure. With pleasure, press down. Shake it with the hand over.
Thank you.
be lost in a world full of sorrow. Without Jesus, somebody tell me, where would I be? It is in your presence, Heavenly Father, we bow again this evening. Our hearts go out in praise and in thanksgiving to you for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Lord, you have called us out of darkness into this your marvelous light. You have provided salvation for us through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We thank you, O God, for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your salvation. We acknowledge you this evening as the Almighty God, the Creator God. We declare that you are God all by yourself. There is none beside you. We claim forgiveness of sins and cleansing through the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, this evening. And we ask again as we open your word, you open our minds, open our understanding, Heavenly Father. Help us this evening to be willing to learn and willing to obey. Again, we pray that you would beat back the powers of darkness and confuse the plans of the enemy. Again, we pray, O God, that you would pull down demonic strongholds and that you would fight against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. O God, again this evening we ask that heaven and angels would surround this place and that the Holy Ghost would be up and down the aisle and in and between the chairs tonight, bringing conviction and conversion, and that Jesus and Jesus alone will be lifted up, and that indeed your word will be fulfilled when men, women, boys and girls will be drawn to call the name of Jesus blessed. Teach us, Heavenly Father, we ask, as we wait on you tonight, we pray with thanksgiving, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Our world in crisis. Our world in crisis. And I can spend perhaps all night out here bringing before you world events and things that are happening all over the world this evening to support the fact that we are living in a world that is in crisis. Of course, the truth is that I don't have to do all that. I don't have the time, nor is it necessary, because I know tonight, you know, that we are living in a world that is in crisis. A world that is heading for destruction. And so we have come to a time when there are multiple crises in our world. I've just chosen to highlight a few of them this evening. And so I begin by saying to you that we are living in a world of political crisis. On every continent of this universe, this world, we find a political crisis. Tonight we know that there is political crisis in Moscow and Ukraine. Tonight we know that indeed a war is raging. Tonight we know that there is a political crisis in Sudan. We know that there is civil war there raging. And hundreds of persons have lost their lives, and thousands are running to save their lives. We know tonight that because of that political crisis, there is a humanitarian crisis which would have been brought on as a result of that political crisis. We know right around this close by here in our neighboring Venezuela, there is also a political crisis that has again brought on a humanitarian crisis. And we being so close neighbors, I indeed feeling the effects of that political crisis with our neighbors next door, is that so? The world is in a state of political crisis. The world is in a state where it's facing a crisis of fear. Hallelujah, you want to speak the truth tonight? I said we are in the midst of a crisis of what? A crisis of fear. I asked you last night, what is the number one concern on your mind in your country? And, you know, everybody, unanimously, the response was crime. We are living in a world of fear. There was fear before COVID-19. Because before COVID-19, we were living in prisons in our homes. Before COVID-19, we were living behind bars. Before COVID-19, we were living with dogs and security systems. Before COVID-19, we had in some parts of our countries and our neighborhood, we would have imposed curfew. We would not have waited for the government to declare a state of emergency and impose curfew, but we would have imposed curfew on ourselves because of fear. Because of fear tonight, there are some parts of our beloved country that we would not go, we would not venture into. Been to Jamaica some time ago, and when I got there, they warned me of certain areas. Somebody gave me a list indicating certain areas of Jamaica that you should not venture into. I imagine so much that visitor coming to Trinidad would also get a list stating certain areas that you should not venture into. What am I speaking to tonight? Fear. And then came COVID-19. And that fear was heightened 1,000 times, that's all. COVID-19 came, and thousands, millions died all over the world. And the people became afraid to step out of their homes, afraid to travel. And the ill effects of COVID-19 and the fear thereof is still with us tonight. People are just afraid. A crisis of fear. And then there's a moral crisis. The world tonight is facing a moral crisis. Things are no longer what they used to be. There is a crisis of morality, a crisis of gender identity. Are you with me this evening? I said a crisis of gender identity. For they are telling us tonight that as parents, we do not even have the right to indicate whether our children are male or female. That the child must be left to come of age, and that the child must decide whether he is male or female. A moral crisis is gripping and destroying the world tonight. The higher you get is the more you realize that homosexuality and lesbianism is indeed a part of their lifestyle and of the community. It would seem that this kind of behavior attracts affluent, well-to-do, big shot, jacket and tie people. And so we have come to a time where if you want to make it in certain circles, then you must identify yourself as belonging to that community of LGBTQ, whatever. A moral crisis. We have come to a time when, as we call it, Trinidad common law living, that is legalized. No longer a big thing in our country, in the Caribbean, throughout the world, and so our young people, more and more our children, are just shacking up. Our children are just shacking up and having children and not being concerned anymore about marriage. So we are in the midst of a moral crisis. Governments have accepted homosexuality. Statesmen have accepted homosexuality. Churchmen have accepted homosexuality. I said churchmen, churches have accepted homosexuality as a normal way of life. We are indeed in a moral crisis. There's corruption all around us. Corruption is the order of the day. I said corruption is the order of the day. Corruption can be found everywhere. And the higher you go is the more corrupt persons you meet. Ordinary, everyday stuff where folks are being paid to perform, they are refusing to perform except you pass something underhand. I said they are already being paid to do the job, but they are refusing to do that job except you grease their hand, listen. Pass something. And that's where we are tonight in the world. A world in crisis. What does it mean? Well, we must understand that all these are indeed signs of the second coming of Jesus. I repeat, all these are signs. They are indicators, harbingers of the second coming of Jesus. How do you know that, preacher? How do you know that? Well, you see, Jesus said that these would happen just before his second coming. I said, how do you know that, preacher? I know that because the Bible tells me so. Jesus himself said these things would characterize the condition of the world just before his second coming. Go with me, therefore, to the word of God tonight. I begin at Matthew 24. We begin to read from verse 3. Then we go to 6 and 7. Jesus said that the world would be in a state of political crisis. What state will the world be in? A state of a political crisis. And the Bible, the word of God, tells us what is his name. Read on for me, reader. And as he what?
And as he sat upon the Mount
of Olives,
the disciples came unto him privately, saying,
yes,
tell us, When shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?
They're asking Jesus these questions. As Jesus will have said to them, certain things would happen after his departure. Now they are asking Jesus these questions. When shall these things be? And what shall be what? The sign of what? The end of the world and of thy coming. Jesus goes on now to give them answers to their questions. We begin to read from verse 6. Let's go. And he what?
And you shall hear of wars. And rumors.
He shall hear what?
Wars.
He shall hear what?
Wars.
Wars. Are we hearing of wars tonight?
Yes, we are.
Are we hearing of wars tonight?
Yes, we are.
Are there rumors of wars tonight? Yes, Jesus said we shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. That's happening all around us in our world tonight. I said on every continent tonight. That's taking place. Go on.
See that he be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet.
Mm-hmm. For what? For nation
shall rise against nation,
and kingdom shall rise against kingdom. Yes, stop there for me tonight. Nation shall do what? Rise against nations. And kingdom shall rise against
kingdom.
Russia has risen up against Ukraine. And North Korea from time to time threatens to rise up against South Korea. And America is concerned about China. And so America is positioning itself even tonight in the Philippines that it might be well positioned, that it might respond to any kind of move by China. Nation shall rise up against nation, and kingdom shall rise up against kindred. And there shall be what? Kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be what? Famines. There shall be what?
Famines
and what? Pestilence in the world, and earthquakes in diverse places. There shall be famines tonight. There is famine in sub-Saharan Africa tonight. There is farming, I'm saying. Farming has hit Africa. Farming is very much alive in the world tonight. People are dying. I said people are dying. And pestilences. I said pestilences. We had AIDS, we had H1N1, we had chicken pox, we had chicken whatever. And then came what? COVID-19. That crippled the world. And now I hear them saying that there is some other thing that parents talk to me concerned about, some kind of foot and foot and hand, is it foot and hand? Foot and hand? Oh, it's foot and mouth. So they are concerned that parents be careful, make sure your child don't put his foot in his. Pestilences, diseases, earthquakes, Syria, Turkey, thousands dying. That's where we are tonight. Jesus said that that would be the condition of the world, a state of political crisis. He said also there will be a fear crisis. Luke 21 verse 26, there will be a fear crisis. People will become afraid. Afraid to walk the streets. Afraid to open the doors. Afraid to travel. Afraid. What did Jesus say? Matthew 21, 26, he said what? Men's what?
Hearts.
Come with me tonight, men's what?
Hearts.
Men's hearts. what? Fearing them for? Fear and for what? Looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Jesus said just before his second return, the world would be in a state of fear. A 14-year-old boy left home to go and collect his little sister in America, and unfortunately, he rang the wrong doorbell. 14-year-old black African youth rang the wrong doorbell, and he almost lost his life.
True.
I said he almost lost his life. He did not open the door to go inside. He simply rang the doorbell. But the occupant on the inside, in this state of what? In this state of what? In this state of fear, asked no questions, but simply came out with gun firing. We are in a world where men and women, boys and girls, are living in fear. For the truth is tonight, it's a fearful thing to be black living in North America. I said it's a fearful thing. The world is in a state of
fear.
Fear. We are living behind bars. I said we are living behind bars. Isn't that so?
True.
The front door is bulletproof, and every window is bulletproof, and the back door is bulletproof. All around us we are bulletproofed. I said all around us we are what? Bulletproofed. And in this state of fear and bulletproofing, sometimes some tragedy breaks out like a fire and we can't get out, because while we want to be bulletproofed, we have put ourselves in a state where we can't escape from fire when we need to escape. It happened recently where? In Siparia. That's all?
True.
It happened recently in Siparia. It is not that we love living behind bars, but we are just downright afraid. Isn't that so? It's not so much that most of us love pit bulls. Pit bulls are ugly dogs. There's some people that are ugly dogs. They're not nice to look at. But we keep people because we are what? We are afraid. And as we know, sometimes that dog that is there to guard us turns on us and on our children. That's where we are this evening, that's all.
True.
A state of fear. Jesus said fear will grip the world just before his second coming. This world that is in a state of crisis is saying to every one of us tonight, Jesus is coming soon. He said that the world will be in a state of moral crisis. Luke 17 and verse 26. Luke 17, 26. Luke 17, 26, Jesus said, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of
Man.
How was it in the days of Noah? Genesis chapter 6. We read verse 5, 11, and 12. Genesis 6, verse 5. And God saw that, come on, God saw what? That the what?
Wickedness.
The wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of what? The thoughts of his heart was only what? Evil continually. I said evil continually. continually a state of moral crisis. The Bible there describes people who have no regard for law and order. I said the Bible describes of people who disregard the laws of God, disregard the commandments of God, disregard the laws of the land. People corrupt, people with evil in their minds, continually. Verse 11 says the earth also was what? Was what?
Corrupt.
Corrupt before God. And the earth was filled with what?
Violence.
And the earth was filled with what?
Violence.
Violence. Therein seems to be a description of Trinidad. I said therein seems to be a description of Trinidad. A land that is corrupt and a land that is full of violence. I repeat, a land that is corrupt and a land that is full of violence. That's the land in which we live tonight, whether we like it or not, whether we accept it or not. It is the land that we now live in, a land that is corrupt and a land that is violent. That's where we are tonight. Jesus said it was like that in Noah's day. And God looked upon the earth and what? Behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. Verse 12 tells us.
And
verse 12 says.
And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth.
Amen. This is what the Bible says this evening, that this moral crisis that grips the world is a sign of the soon coming of Jesus. I said it's a sign of the nearness of the return of Jesus. Jesus himself promised that he would come again.
Amen.
I thank God that Jesus himself promised he will come again.
Amen.
I said Jesus himself promised he would come again. John chapter 14, we begin to read from verse 1, we stop at verse 3. Jesus himself speaking to his concerned disciples when they learned that he was going to go away. They were concerned, but Jesus assured them that he's going away, and just as he's going, he will come again. He said to them, what? Let not your what? Your heart be troubled. He believe what? In God, and then they what? Believe also in me. Go on, Mina. In the Father's house are many mansions. If it were not, I would have done what? I would have told you, Jesus said. I'm doing what? I what? I go. I go to do what? I go to do what? I go to do what? Prepare. I'm saying to God's people tonight that Jesus Christ has gone to prepare a place for us. I'm repeating to God's people tonight that Jesus Christ has gone to prepare a place for us. He has gone to prepare a special place. He has gone to prepare a place, a customized place. I said a customized place. If you are taller, then that place will be prepared for your tallness. If you are shorter, that place shall be prepared for your shortness. If you are fatter, then that place shall be prepared for your fatness. If you are slimmer, that place shall be prepared for your slimness. Jesus has got prepared a special place for his people tonight. Shut up! go to prepare a place for you. And I will do what? I will do what? I will do what? I will come again and receive you unto
myself.
Receive you unto
myself,
that where I am, there he may be also. I receive you unto myself, that where I am, there he may be also. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus is coming again. He has gone to prepare a special place, and he's coming again.
Amen.
I said he's coming again. I said he's coming again. When Jesus comes a second time, he is not coming as a babe in Bethlehem. Have the preacher somebody tonight. I said when Jesus comes a second time, he is not coming as a babe in Bethlehem. When Jesus comes a second time, he is not coming to grow up in obscurity in Nazareth. When Jesus comes a second time, he is not coming to walk the dusty streets of Galilee. When Jesus comes a second time, he is not coming that men might mock him and scoff him and spit upon him and stretch his hands out to the cross and nail them there and put his feet together and nail them there. When Jesus comes a second time, he is not coming that men might lift up that cross and violently trust it into the ground, rip it through his flesh, and stand there mocking and scoffing and deriding. When Jesus comes a second time, he is coming with his power. He is coming with his Father's power. He is coming with his glory. He is coming with his Father's glory. He is coming with 10,000, not 10,000, and 1,000 of angels. When Jesus comes a second time, he is coming as King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Amen. God be praised.
It shall be an audible coming.
Amen.
Go with me to Psalm, the 50th division. and stop at verse 3. Psalm 50 and verse 3 says, our God shall come.
Amen.
I said, our God shall come and shall not keep silence. I hope that by tomorrow night you can get those screens going, because I'm missing my people reading with me. I'm missing hearing the voices reading with me. So I hope that you can put that in place by tomorrow night. But if you have your Bibles and your devices and so on, read with the preacher tonight. Get to Psalm 50 and stop at verse 3 and let me hear your voices tonight. Amen? Our God shall what? Our God shall what? I don't hear you. Our God shall what? Our God shall come and shall not keep silence. A fire shall devour before him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about him. Keep that text there for me. Keep that text. The word says, our God shall come and shall not keep silence. Shall not be quiet. Shall not be quiet. Shall not keep silence. A fire shall devour from before him. I said, a fire shall devour from before him. If this tent gets on fire, God forbid, could it be kept a secret?
No.
Could it be kept a secret?
No.
A fire shall devour from before him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about him. It shall be very stormy round about him. It shall be like hurricane round about him. That's what that word tempestuous means. It shall be stormy. It shall be like hurricane. When that storm and hurricane comes by, is it a secret? Does it keep quiet? So likewise, Jesus will come. Amen?
Amen.
His coming is a visible coming.
Yes, sir.
His coming is an audible coming.
True.
1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 16 and 17, Jesus, Paul tells us that Jesus is coming again. Amen? He's coming again. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. Will that be a quiet thing? Will that be a quiet thing? With a shout. I said with a shout. Some people tell me, preacher, you like to shout too much. Preacher, you always shout here. Well, if you think my shout is a shout, wait until you hear the shout of Jesus. I said with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and what? The trump of God. I said the trump of God. And what will happen? The dead in Christ shall rise first. Can that be kept secret?
No.
Can that be done in a corner?
No.
No, this cannot be kept secret. Can be done in a corner when the dead comes back to life. And then those who are what? Who are what? Who remain, who are alive. Those of us who are alive to see Jesus. Paul said we shall be what? Caught up to gather in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. Jesus is coming again. And Paul says the Lord himself. I love that. I love that. The angels told the disciples in Acts 1 verses 9-11. The same Jesus that you see go up in the clouds will likewise come down in the clouds. Paul says the Lord himself shall descend. I love that. Paul says, the Bible says, God says that Jesus himself shall come again for his people. You see, as I study the word of God, I've seen at times where God has to communicate with his people. He has to interact with them, and he will send the angel Gabriel. corruption shall put on incorruption. When it comes to a job like that, Jesus will not need a forgive, brother. He will do it himself. 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 This same Jesus. This same compassionate Jesus. This same loving Jesus. This same caring Jesus. This same forgiving Jesus. Jesus, this same Jesus shall come again.
Amen.
I look forward to that day.
Yes.
Oh boy, I live for that day. I said I live for that day when Jesus will come again. Every day as I get on my knees and as I pray, I say, Lord, you have promised that you are coming again. You have promised that you will cut short this work in righteousness. You said that this gospel shall be preached in all the world for witness, and then shall the end come. Jesus, I'm out there at Lime Boulevard, and I'm preaching this gospel because I want the gospel to be preached in all the world, so that Jesus, you can come. Jesus, I want you to come. Jesus, I say, Jesus, you said you have cut short this work in righteousness for the next sake, and therefore, Jesus, cut short the work and come. Jesus, come. Come, take me out of this place of corruption. Come, take me out of this place of violence. Jesus, come, take me out of this place of wickedness. Jesus, even so, Lord Jesus, come.
Amen. Lord, be praised.
Oh, Jesus is coming. He's coming. He's coming again. I said he's coming again. And that's why the songwriter says, lift up the trumpet. I'm not hearing tonight. I said, lift up the trumpet and now let it ring. Jesus is coming again. Cheer up, ye pilgrims. Be joyful and sing. Jesus is coming again. Coming again. Coming again. Jesus is coming again. Nations are angry. Help the preacher somebody tonight. I said nations are angry. By this we know that Jesus is coming again. Coming again. Coming again. Yes, Jesus is coming again. For the golden morning is fast approaching, and Jesus soon will come, hallelujah, to take his faithful and happy children to their promised home. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of doom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb. I'm longing for that day when face to face with Christ my Savior, face to face, what will it be? When the rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ, who died for me. Face to face shall I behold him, far, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory. Oh, Jesus is coming. I said, Jesus is coming. I said, Jesus is coming. And I know not what I shall be, but I know that I shall be like him. Let me speak to somebody. I know not what I shall be, but I know that I shall be like Jesus, for I shall see him face to face.
Amen.
He is coming again. I said he's coming again. He's coming for his people. I said he's coming for his people. He's not coming for everybody. He's not coming for Los Angeles. I'm paying 200 confirm he's coming for his. And so the big question that you are settling your mind tonight, are you a part of his people? I repeat the question, you must leave this tent assured of tonight with a positive answer, is whether you are a part of the people of Jesus.
Yes, sir.
He's coming for his people. He says, my sheep, they hear my voice. They know my voice, and they follow me. I do expect everybody who listens to the voice of this preacher to follow Jesus. Because Jesus said that my sheep, they, because they know my voice. I said my sheep, Jesus said, they know my voice. You see, they know my voice, Jesus says. That's what I want to emphasize tonight. They know my voice. In this world, there are so many voices, Jesus says. My sheep, they know my voice. And so they can recognize my voice. They can pick up my voice amid the many voices. They will hear my voice because they know my voice, and they will follow me.
Amen.
So tonight I'm preaching, believing that Jesus has brought into the tent tonight his sheep.
Amen.
I said I'm preaching tonight, believing that Jesus has brought into the tent tonight his sheep.
Amen.
Who will know his voice.
Yes, sir.
Who will hear his voice. And who will follow him.
Amen.
He's saying to us tonight, be ready.
Amen.
I said, be ready. Not get ready. But be ready. If you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Master, if you have accepted him as your Savior, if you have confessed your sins to him, if you have asked him for forgiveness of sins tonight, if you have claimed his promise, and if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, then tonight you are numbered among the sheep of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
That's how we belong to Jesus. By faith, as we confess our sinfulness and cry out for his forgiveness and accept his sacrifice on our behalf, and we become joined to Jesus. We begin our saving relationship with Jesus tonight.
Amen.
If I'm describing your relationship tonight with Jesus, just lift your hand.
Amen.
If what I've said is a description of where you are, lift your hand.
Amen.
That is, if you have asked for forgiveness, if you have said, Jesus, I'm sorry, if you have claimed this promise of forgiveness tonight, then you are there. Raise your hands tonight.
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God.
Amen.
Every hand should be up tonight. Because Jesus says, be ready.
Amen.
You don't have to perform some task. You don't have to go on some pilgrimage somewhere. You don't have to produce tens of thousands of dollars. All you have to do is say, Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins.
Amen.
Forgive me of my sins. Accept me. For I accept you tonight as my Lord and my Savior. I wish that everybody would say that tonight to yourself, so that you could have your life settled in Jesus.
Amen.
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 He's coming again. He wants all of us to be saved. And if you are saying, preacher, I'm going to be ready when Jesus comes, Not that I'm going to get you any, but I'm going to be rich. And Jesus comes, for I want to be saved in his kingdom. Then just stand to your feet there you are. Just stand as we have our closing prayer this evening. If you are saying, Jesus, I want to be saved when you come. I want to be in your kingdom when you come. Just stand to your feet. Stand to your feet tonight. Praise God this evening. Praise God this evening. Praise God this evening. I want to talk to somebody here tonight as I close. Somebody here tonight as I close. Tonight you are saying to Jesus, perhaps for the first time you have come to a church service like this, and you are saying, Jesus, I love you. I accept your salvation. Thanks for saving me. I'm going to be ready when you come. Just take a walk and meet me here. That's all you are saying tonight. Somebody. Perhaps you have never said it like that before. You've never been in a church service like this before. But you are saying tonight publicly, Jesus, I am going to be saved. I'm accepting you as Savior. That's all I'm asking you to declare tonight. You're accepting Jesus as your Savior. You're accepting his salvation. That's the first set of people I'm asking. Anybody like that here tonight? You just want to say, Jesus, I'm accepting you as my Savior. And I'm taking a walk of faith in Jesus. I'm accepting you. I'm declaring that you are my Savior. Here tonight. Anybody want to say that tonight? Anybody need help to come forward? You want to come and say, Jesus, I'm accepting you as my Savior. Just lift your hand. Somebody will help you. Somebody will give you hold your hands and help you come. That's all you are saying. Jesus, I accept you as my Savior tonight. Anybody for the first time? That's why we are here to preach. So that people will accept Jesus as Savior. Young or old will accept Jesus as Savior. I'm going to ask folks to help you tonight. So I'm going to ask those who have already accepted Jesus as Savior. And you want to say, Jesus, we will remain faithful until you come. Just come and put your hand in front here. Come, come. And help somebody know who needs to come. You have already accepted Jesus. You are saying, Jesus, I'm going to remain faithful. Because I've accepted you as my Lord and my Savior.